Hello, everybody. Dr. Anthony Pasek here with the Wellness Connection. Today, we're going to talk about the gut in a very specific topic, something that we see pretty regularly here in practice. We're going to talk about SIBO, SIBO, and what that stands for is small intestine bacterial overgrowth. We'll go into what it actually is, how it shows up, what are some of the causes, and then very importantly, what do you do about it? So, if you ever experience digestive symptoms, one of the most common things that you may feel or describe is bloating. And really, what does bloating mean? It can mean different things to different people. Bloating, when we see SIBO, is usually pretty specific. It's often in the abdomen fairly soon after you eat, maybe within 20 to 30 minutes or up to an hour. Almost the feeling of like just expansion or fullness or gas pressure, or almost like the feeling of if you could imagine a balloon was inside your abdomen and it was inflating with air. That's a very common thing for people to describe that have, turns out, have SIBO, small intestine bacterial overgrowth. So it can also show up in a few other ways. In general, things like IBS are just kind of a catch-all diagnosis or label for irritable bowel syndrome. If you experience IBS type symptoms, SIBO might be the cause. Sometimes there's cramping that comes along with this. Sometimes there's constipation that comes along with this. Sometimes there's diarrhea. Sometimes the sensation of gas, either burping or flatulence, or just gurgling and rumbling in the tummy. I would also say that anytime we're experiencing reflux, there's a chance that SIBO is involved here. So I would like to show a little diagram that would really help to visualize what we're dealing with here when we look at SIBO. When we zoom in here, this is a diagram of our gut from top to bottom. And in the orange here is your mouth. So when you eat food, you chew it up and it goes down your esophagus and pretty quickly ends up in your stomach. Your stomach, very importantly, should have significant amounts of stomach acid in it. We'll talk about why that's important in just a moment, but stomach acid is really plays a critical role in SIBO, more importantly, keeping you from getting SIBO. So once food leaves your stomach, it goes into your small intestine, which is this orange area in the center here. Your small intestine is very small in diameter, but it's very, very long in length. So once food enters your small intestine, it might be in there for many, many hours as it passes through. After food leaves your small intestine, it then enters your large intestine, which is in green here. Your large intestine is very big in diameter, but it's fairly short. You can see it just kind of making a little 90 degree turn here and here, and then ultimately stool ends up leaving. So when we look at the journey of food through your digestive system, the small intestine is one of the first stops. It's the first place that your food goes right outside of your stomach. If we look at the bacteria or the probiotics or the microbes that live in your gut, there's a fair amount of microbes that live in your mouth and potentially in your esophagus. Once we get to the stomach, there really should not be very many bacteria at all. Your stomach is extremely acidic and it has the effect of killing most microbes that come in contact with this area. So when you eat food, if you have appropriate levels of stomach acid, it will often neutralize bacteria and stuff that are in your food. So once food leaves your stomach and enters your small intestine, or if we just look at the bacteria level, there should not be very many bacteria in your small intestine, in a normal, healthy small intestine. You'll also notice it's kind of tucked in up here, but in green, right under the liver here, which is red, you'll see your gallbladder. And the gallbladder and the stomach play a very important role in SIBO. So your small intestine, fairly sterile, meaning not a lot of microbes. There are some, but not a lot. The vast majority of bacteria or probiotics, good bacteria in your gut, should live in your large intestine, which is really the very end of the digestive tract. So SIBO is bacterial overgrowth in the small intestine. When the orange small intestine ends up growing more bacteria than should be there, that's how we get SIBO. I want to talk just a little bit about sort of the symptoms, and then we'll come back to some of the causes here. But what we often find when we experience SIBO is if you were to eat food, even healthy food, and it's often healthy food like a salad, or even just sometimes people tell me, I just get up in the morning and if I just drink water, I feel bloated. How does that happen? What is causing that? Water and plant fiber from vegetables or even fruit, if that enters your mouth, you swallow it, goes past your stomach and into your small intestine. If there is a lot more bacteria in your small intestine and the food and the water arrive there within 20 minutes of you eating, an hour of you eating, which they can, those fibers and that water can feed those bacteria. They can grow and divide. And one of the byproducts of that is gas. So that gas can expand outward and leave you the sensation of bloating, often in the abdomen. It can create gas that contains methane that is very constipating. So when we see constipation as a result, that doesn't seem to respond to other treatments, it can often be coming from SIBO. And the last area that gas can go often is very short trip through the stomach and back up and out into the esophagus. And that is where you get reflux, heartburn, things like that. So there's other mechanisms for that, but that's one of the most common things that we see. This gas being produced by SIBO leaves the small intestine, goes up through the stomach, and takes with it some stomach acid. So what some of the most common causes of SIBO are, we can see on this diagram. If you have low levels of stomach acid, primarily from taking medication to reduce stomach acid, like Zantac or omeprazole, proton pump inhibitors or antihistamines, heartburn medications, those things will reduce your body's ability to make stomach acid. And it is a little bit ironic because sometimes that actual heartburn that you're feeling is a result of SIBO, that gas being produced and coming back and up. And then if you take something to try to help with the symptom, you might actually be making the cause worse. So we do often find that if stomach acid is not where it needs to be, that's just an open door for bacteria to grow and divide in the small intestine. The last one I'll show you on this diagram is the gallbladder. If your gallbladder is not functioning properly, or if you've had your gallbladder removed, you do not make as much bile, or your bile doesn't get injected into the small intestine as well as it should. What you can't quite see here, right outside the stomach, is where the bile duct inserts bile into the small intestine. And that plays a very important role. It sort of acts almost like soap. It's an emulsifier to help digest fats, but that also helps to kind of pass bacteria along through the small intestine so that it doesn't have a chance to grow and take root here. So the role of gallbladder and bile are pretty critical in preventing SIBO. So there are a few other things that can cause this. I'm going to stop sharing here, but if you have slow moving bowels, we call that motility. If the muscles that move the food through your digestive tract are not working as well as they should, that can cause the bacteria to grow and divide in the small intestine as well. That can happen for a few reasons. If you've had surgery, certain surgeries can affect your motility. If you have nerve damage, there's a condition called gastroparesis, which can happen from things like diabetes or even things like multiple sclerosis. Damage to the nerves can change the body's ability to move food and bacteria through your small intestine. Another one that's very common cause for constipation is a low thyroid function. We have talked about that at length here, and we will again on future videos. But anything that's going to slow down movement of your gut could create problems with SIBO. There are also foods that can do this. Certainly, gluten exposure is at the top of that list. Gluten can make SIBO significantly worse. And certainly eating refined sugars and flours, things like that, will make it much easier for those bacteria to grow and divide in the small intestine. Also, medications like opioids are notorious for constipating people. And most people that have taken medications like that realize, hey, I'm not having as many bowel movements as I was before. Anything that's going to slow things down digestive-wise will have a risk for increasing SIBO here. So the causes can be varied. Sometimes it's multiple. Hopefully the symptoms are pretty clear at this point as well. What you do about it really depends on who you ask. So in our clinic, we find this pretty commonly just from talking to people symptomatically and clinically. It kind of makes sense that this sounds like SIBO. As far as testing goes, we get information about SIBO from stool testing. And there are specialized tests that that require drinking a solution of sugar and then blowing gas samples into a little bag. That's called a breath test for SIBO. We will often order that for patients as well. Some gastroenterologists, GI specialists, will order testing like that as well. There's many different ways to figure out if SIBO is a component here. The treatment for it can be pharmaceuticals. We don't often have to do that. There are many people that have gone through that route and have had success. And then there are other people that have gone that route and not had great success. So there are natural approaches that you can take. There are broad spectrum herbal antimicrobials that we use regularly that have quite good success. There is other formulas out there that that are really helpful for the bloating component of SIBO that can be really effective to kind of keep that stuff at bay. And sometimes that's a first line defense that people will use as well. But I often find that it requires a really comprehensive approach to see what are the contributing factors here, especially if it keeps coming back, or if you can't figure out why am I bloated here, what is happening. So if any of this stuff sounds familiar, if you struggle with these things and not quite gotten the results that you want, please feel free to reach out and let us know. We'd be happy to help you out. That's it for today. See you later, guys.